This is module one. It's privilege of the Bihar Orthopedic Association to welcome all the renowned orthopedics faculty, different aims from across the country. I wish you all the very best, and I request our respected president, Professor S.N. Saraf sir, to say a few words.
Thank you, Dr. Madhusudan. Am I audible, Madhusudan? Avazari?
Yes, sir.
Good evening, everyone. On behalf of Bihar Orthopedic Association, I welcome all the respected faculties and dignitaries in this first AIIMS Spine webinar. This is first ever spine deformities series, module number one, low-grade spondylolisthesis, under aegis of Bihar Orthopedic Association. This topic is one of its kind and very interesting. In listhesis, we have so many new things to know, like its modern classification, its marker of progression, radiological prognosticators, spinopelvic morphology, and many more things to be known. There is much advancement in modern medicine and management of listhesis. We started from posterolateral fusion to PLIF to TLIF, and now ELIF, DLIF, OLIF, and XLIF in its train. I'm sure in this webinar, we will be concluding many confusion and will come to some concluding remarks. Thank you. Now I hand over to moderator.
Thank you, sir. So it was our dream to bring all the aims together for a new webinar, and after 2 years of deliberation among ourselves, we have come with a small webinar and we'll try to take it forward, and all the aims faculties will be sharing their experiences, and I'm very grateful that all are here. It was first talked with Dr. Pankaj sir, and then Bhavuk sir is also there on the panel here, so it's very thankful to all. So Pankaj sir, can we start, and then we'll start with our lectures.
Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all for this first webinar. I have to congratulate Team Patna, Dr. Avinash, for taking the initiative. This was in pipeline for very long. I remember we had plenty of discussions previously, but I'm glad that Patna came forward, and it's a good initiative. I also welcome the president of Bihar Orthopedic Association and secretary for giving this opportunity. I think this webinar is going to be very useful. The target audience is going to be the resident doctors, if I'm not wrong, Avinash.
Yes,
and
sir.
Also practicing spine surgeons. And hopefully we'll come up with the conclusive, or we'll incorporate what is the current evidence in the management of low-grade spondylolisthesis, so that the advantage can be passed on to the patients, and it will be good for the resident training as well. Welcome all, and I hand over the mic again to Avinash. Thank you.
So our first lecture is by Mantu sir. He's a associate professor at AIIMS Bhubaneswar, and he'll be talking about radiological assessment of spondylolisthesis. And we'll try to make it more discussion-oriented webinar than of more of a theoretical based. Hope all will participate in this. Over to you, sir. Sir, unmute yourself.
So I thank once again the Bihar Orthopedic Association for giving me an opportunity to present in this forum. And I will be speaking on radiological assessment of low-grade listhesis. So we all know that listhesis is one of the penalties which human pay for their bipedal posture. So I'll be speaking on, I think some problem, just a second. So in my presentation, I'll be speaking on identifying the low-grade listhesis, the radiological parameters on X-ray about this listhesis, the MRI and the SPECT scan, and also the radiological finding of various grades of low-grade listhesis. So the grading scale was first given by Meyerding et al. In the year 1932, in which a grade of less than 50% is low-grade listhesis, with type 1 less than 25% and type 2 25 to 50%. But here there is a catch. One need to identify the true and acidolisthesis. So whenever there is a difference of the end plates of the superior and the inferior end plate vertebra, it can give an impression of a false listhesis. And here the Ullmann sign, that is a line drawn perpendicular to the superior end plate, is very handy. So whenever the anterior-inferior corner of the vertebra crosses or touches this line, it is a true listhesis. So the standard X-ray will include a AP and a lateral right from the dorsum up to the level of the hip joints. And on a lateral view, the posterior cortical line will be a smooth line. Whenever there is a rotation, a double cortical shadow will be seen. But nowadays, it is prudent to take a whole spine view right from the C7 up to the level of the hips. So the oblique views are the 45 degree rotational views. And in these are helpful to detect a pars defect. So whenever there is a pars defect, either a decapitated Scottish dog sign is seen. So the instability can be seen best directly by a dynamic X-ray. And the dynamic X-ray can be taken on a standing erect flexion extension view or a recumbent flexion extension view. There are also hanging views and sometimes views taken with weights on. Prone view and also prone traction view are also taken nowadays, which was described by D'Andre et al. So various authors have given various figures and numbers to describe this radiological instability. But what is consensus and what we also follow is that whenever there is a dynamic change of more than 10 degree or a dynamic anterior translation of more than 4 millimeter, it is labeled as radiological instability. There are some indirect signs of instability which can be seen on a X-ray, CT and MRI. Whenever there is a tractional spur or a vacuum phenomenon which is seen on X-ray or a CT, or a facetal fluid with more than 1.5 millimeter, or a synovial cyst or an interspinous fluid on an MRI, these are signs of instability. So there are three sacropelvic parameters which are important, of which the pelvic incidence is a morphological parameter, and the pelvic tilt and sacral slope are the positional parameters. So depending upon the pelvic incidence, the SDSG group has divided the low-grade listhesis into three types. Type 1 is the one with the pelvic incidence less than 45 degree, otherwise known as the nutcracker type. Type 2 is the one with the pelvic incidence of 45 to 60 degrees. Type 3 is the one with a high pelvic incidence, and this is otherwise called as a shear type. Now, the concept of balance of the pelvis and sacrum is very critical in case of high-grade listhesis, but nevertheless, they need to be done in low-grade listhesis. A balanced spine is the one in which the C7 plumb line falls at or behind the femoral heads, and a person having a high sacral slope and a low pelvic tilt denotes a balanced pelvis. So other radiological parameters should include a segmental and an intradiscal lordosis and measurement of the lumbosacral angle. So coming to the various types, the dysplastic or the congenital variety are two types. One is a high grade in which there is a junctional kyphosis, the L5 becomes trapezoid, there is a sacral dome, and the posterior elements are also dysplastic. But a low type is the one in which the junctional kyphosis is less, the L5 vertebral body is also more or less rectangular, the sacral dome is absent, and the transverse processes are also nearly normal. So the isthmic variety can be seen on an oblique X-ray, but on a CT scan, if you find a sharp, poorly corticated and a narrow fracture line, then it is an acute fracture, whereas one with a smooth, well corticated and a wide fracture line, then it is a chronic non-union. So when you find or suspect a stress fracture, it is best seen on a SPECT scan in which there is an increased uptake. So sometimes on an MRI, you also find the hyperintensity, which can be appreciated on a stair picture or a TW-weighted images, and they appear hypo-intense on a T1-weighted images. So again, the degree of hyperintensity correlates with the degree of severity of stress reaction. So the traumatic spondylolisthesis is seen in the lumbosacral junction. So there is a usually associated L5 transverse fracture because of the rupture of the iliofemoral ligament. Sometimes hyperextension injuries can lead to laminar fractures. So on an AP view, you find a transverse fracture and somewhat obliquity of the L5 body. And on the lateral view, besides the disc height reduction, we also see a sharp kyphosis and increase in the interspinous distance. So in the degenerative variety, the translation is not as much as other varieties, but there is a lot of segmental or the angular kyphosis, and there is a disc height which is reduced, and asymmetric collapse can lead to scoliosis, which can be seen on the AP view. There can also be a lateral translation, and the associated spinal stenosis can be well appreciated on an MRI, and they can be graded using a Shiza's grading. There are some situations in which this degenerative listhesis can appear on multiple level, and they can produce a step ladder pattern type of X-ray. Sometimes during evaluation of a scoliosis, you can also find a subtle listhesis more so in the lumbosacral junction. And here is one X-ray showing a bifid spinous process showing a dysplasia. So to summarize, radiological assessment of low-grade listhesis begins with identification of the listhesis, seeing the overall balance of the pelvis and the spine, documenting instability either directly by using a dynamic X-ray or looking for subtle signs of instability, and finally getting an MRI to document the neurological status of the patient. Thank you. Thank you for your patient hearing.
Thank you, sir. I would like from anyone from panelists to ask any questions, or if anyone want to discuss something, or should I ask that when do you generally ask for dynamic X-rays when a patient comes with a low back ache with a radiculopathy? Gurdeep?
Yeah, Dr. Avinash. In two scenarios, I do order dynamic X-rays where I am suspecting that there could be a subtle instability, and the MRI has already been done and I see that there is a facetal effusion, but I want to document the instability. Or is that there is a scenario where the patient is complaining of predominant back pain and less of radicular pain. So I want to document any hidden instability. That is one situation where I do dynamic X-rays. If for any reason I find it that the patient is not able to get a dynamic X-ray because of the intolerable pain, at least I do get a standing X-ray of the lumbosacral spine.
Mantu, sir?
Yes, one thing I would like to add, that whenever the patient comes with clinical signs of instability, like there is an extensor catch, or the patient has a painful flexion arc, or a painful extension. So those when you have clinically suspect that there is instability, it must also be supplemented with radiological documentation.
One question will be to Mantu, sir. Do you, sir, routinely recommend flexion extension X-rays before venturing for surgical intervention?
Yes, getting a documenting the instability is very important, because you know that listhesis is a dynamic situation. Initially there is instability, and later on with progress of disease there is also auto stabilization. So whether documenting getting a dynamic X-ray and documenting instability is very important.
So Mantu, sir,
flexion extension view.
Mantu, sir.
Yes, sir.
How frequently you ask for whole spine X-ray, AP lateral, standing?
So previously, actually, we were not doing a whole spine X-ray, particularly in low-grade listhesis. But nowadays, with these sacral parameters, which are now a matter of topic everywhere, we are now getting a whole spine view for all patients of listhesis.
But in all age group, you will get it done?
Yes, yes. For all grade and all age group.
Okay.
Bhavuk sir, do you get measure sacropelvic parameters for grade 1 and grade 2 listhesis?
Yes, every case, every single case. I will show you that how I plan my TLIF case.
Okay.
We measure everything in every case.
Sir, do you measure L4 obliquity angles?
We basically look at the we measure all the angles, you know, as because the research projects are already going on, so each and every angle is measured. But the thing is, normally we look at the lumbar lordosis as a whole, and then we try to restore the lumbar kyphosis, whatever the kyphosis there, we restore the lumbar lordosis at that particular segment. That is our main aim. So all the angles, they are, you know, just the indirect evidence of kyphosis at that particular segment.
Is there any trip to get a true lateral view in spine?
As such, there is no distinct fixed guidelines. But the thing is that if the patient doesn't have any rotational deformity, then this lateral is just orthogonal to the this thing. The only important thing is that if you are getting the whole spine X-ray done, then there are, you know, different things that how the patient's hand should be positioned. So ideally, we ask the patient to keep their the fingers and the thumb on the clavicle, on their clavicle, and the elbows, they are at the shoulders are at the 90 degrees.
Sometimes we see lateral X-ray to be totally aligned, but when we ask for flexion, there is some displacement. So when do you suspect to get a flexion X-ray when there is normal alignment in a lateral view of a spine?
So when we order the X-rays, you know, we always get the whole series done. You know, we don't send the patient to again that you just show me AP and lateral X-ray and then we will say, okay, I'm suspecting instability. Then you go for flexion extension views. So, you know, the getting appointments and all these are also very difficult things. So straight away, the standard investigation, if a patient is getting investigated, we order X-ray, AP, lateral and flexion extension views.
In all backache patients or the patients having painful flexion extension?
Any patient who is getting X-rays, we are advising X-rays, they get the whole series of X-rays done. Unless, okay. And if we are surgically, if we are planning surgically, then they get the whole spine X-rays done.
So generally at our center, we go for dynamic X-ray when there is neurogenic claudication, we are not seeing any misalignment in a lateral X-ray view. So neurogenic claudication is one criteria where we always go for dynamic X-rays. Bikram sir, can we go for a second lecture? Bikram sir?
Maybe Dr. Upendra can also point out, sir. I think...
Upendra sir, what's your take on dynamic X-ray?
Yeah. I mean, basically, if you are suspecting any instability, we do get it. And as Bau told, most of the patients who come for backache and we investigate with X-rays, we do flexion extension in the same sitting. Many a times, another thing we need to remember is if we are doing a surgery, we do not suspect that the above level might be unstable. When you get a flexion extension, actually that comes in the way. So, you know, instead of having an adjacent segment, you can address that at the same time. So it is very important you get it. As a routine, you can get it. Should not be an issue at all.
How so sitting X-ray and standing X-ray make the difference?
Yeah, I didn't get you. What
problem? Sitting lateral view and sitting standing lateral view. Is there any difference in picking these two?
Yeah, standing lateral view is important as we get the whole spine X-rays also. It is important that you load the spine and get the lateral view. So in that, many of the instabilities and alignment will come into the picture. So we do always get a standing one.
Sitting and standing lateral, I only get for the coccygodynia patients, in which we look at the mobility of the coccyx. Otherwise, as such, for lumbar sacral spine, sitting and standing lateral view is not so important.
Sitting spine lateral view is going to probably cause one issue also. If the patient has a posterior hip caps, tight hip capsules, then you can get abnormal spine movements at that point because of the sitting posture. That also be a bias, source of bias.
Thank you, sir.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir, audible.
Okay, good evening, everybody. First of all, I am very thankful to the Bihar Orthopedic Association and appreciate the effort of Dr. Avinash, who was working with us few years back, and now he's doing good in his partner. So it was planned before 2 years back. Now they have been realized. Thank you, Dr. Avinash. Thank you for Bihar Orthopedic Association and all my colleagues. My topic of presentation is low-grade spondylolisthesis, when not to operate or when to operate. So if you see the history of spondylolisthesis, most of the cases, either it is an incidental finding or an accidental finding. Initially, it was discovered by Harbin Ox, and to be as an interesting fact, She was an obstetrician in Belgium who has discovered this spondylolisthesis in his head. Neither a neurosurgeon or orthopedic surgeon or spinal surgeon has not discovered the spondylolisthesis. So many times it is an incidental finding, and Kilian has named the term, coined the term of spondylolisthesis. Dr. Mantu has classified all these things according to the radiological classification or etiology on the basis of the etiology or pathogenesis. It has been classified as a developmental or acquired due to the lysis or elongation of the parts mostly. If it is highly dysplastic, it is a highly dysplastic type, or it is with the minimal, it is low dysplastic type. And how it is highly dysplastic, Dr. Mantu has described very nicely. The sacral dome is rounded, the trapezoid shape of the L5 vertebra, and all these things will be pertinent to a high grade dysplastic type. Then acquired type, most common is the degenerative type, and traumatic pathology post-surgery are also less common, but they are also found in our clinical settings. So it is actually a common occurrence. If you see the lysis part, the dysplastic type, the spondylolisthesis is a common occurrence in children and adolescents. If you see the statistics, around 10% of the general population will get spondylolisthesis, and 40% of the athletes you will get spondylolisthesis. It may be due to a articular defect in the parts, or is a mechanical stress fracture of the parts interarticulars. But should all these patients need surgery? That is a big question. Depending on the severity of the spondylolisthesis and symptom associated with it, it can be treated conservatively or surgically with similar success. Literature has shown that high success rate of conservative treatment in spondylolisthesis with listhesis is found. If you see a beautiful literature with a big series of 500 cases with a very longest duration of follow-up, that is 45 years of follow-up. He has taken 500 cases of spondylolisthesis in children and followed up to the 45 years. He found that only 6% of cases, that is only 30% of the patient, had spondylolisthesis in adulthood. Others had healed. Out of the 30%, only 8%, which has unilateral parts defect, developed spondylolisthesis. Did not develop spondylolisthesis. Only 22 who had bilateral parts defect, they developed spondylolisthesis. This is a eye-catching literature. So we showed the natural history of the disease. So when to operate, when not to operate, we should be judgmental over. In case of a low-grade spondylolisthesis 1 or 2 or spondylolisthesis, if there is no impairment of the daily living activity, it can be managed conservatively very efficiently. In grade 3, 4 or 5th grade, the decision to take surgically is still controversial. Literature shows that if there is a randomization and comparison between conservatively treated and treated operatively, they have a similar quality of life that has a minimal symptom and managed conservatively has similar quality of life, those who are having symptomatic patient and treated surgically. Yes, there is also indication of surgery. If there is a high sleep angle, you know what is a sleep angle? This is a sleep angle. If you draw a tangential line at the posterior part of the S1 and perpendicular to that one, that first line, and third line is along the L5 border. If it is dystrophic, then you may take the upper border also. This sleep angle, if it is more than 55 degree, then there is a high chance of further progression of the sleep. Even after a fusion surgery, literature, European Spine Journal said that even after a fusion surgery, there is a chance of further slip. So how to manage a lysis? If all these cases needs conservative treatment or all these cases need surgery, acute defect of fracture or acute defect or a fracture is a stress reaction, which can be diagnosed by an MRI, by a bony edema, or there will be a sclerosis by the CT scan. In some centers, they use SPECT also for diagnosing whether it is an acute stress fracture or it is a stress reaction. So if you are getting a stress fracture, acute defect, then it is best healed with cast brace immobilization. No need to jump for surgery. A structural rehabilitation program, mostly in sports activity in children, because it is mostly found in children. So a structural rehabilitation program is necessary to return this patient to sports activity. So chronic spondylitis defect, where there is a sclerosis on the CT scan or X-ray, we recommend a yearly examination with a standing lateral X-ray view. First, you have to rule out infection, osteodystoma, or prolapse disc in these cases, so that we are not missing some grave situations. But if these things are ruled out, then we need only an yearly spot lateral examination, which on standing view, very small percentage of patients may require a surgery. This is what the literature says. So there are so many types of repair. The surgical colleague, the surgeon who will talk on this technique of the surgery, spot repair, direct tissue, screw repair, screw and hook repair. There are so many techniques. I will not discuss on that thing. But literature says the hook, screw hook rod and screw rod construct provides a better mode of stability than the modified stock and box technique, which is a wearing figure eight technique. That is a technique which is randomly used in many centers. But literature says that screw rod hook technique provides a better mode of stability. And there are many controversy regarding the spacer, ventral laminar length construct. But if you see the literature of the spine journal, it says that it is provides an effective method of biomechanical, gives an effective method of biomechanical strength with excellent clinical results that a study on interlaminar spacers. So now coming to the degenerative listasis. It results from the progressive degenerative changes due to intervertebral disc and the facet joints, leading to the further slippage of the vertebra over another due to the sagittalization of the facet joint. This is a very important aspect. This facet tropism or sagittalization of the facet joint, that is a very pertinent finding in degenerative listasis, which occurs more often in women in L4, L5 is the most common site. But this degenerative listasis rarely exceeds 30% more slip. So, and many a times it does not correlate with the degree of the symptom, the clinical manifestation, the clinical finding, the clinical presentation does not always correlate with the degree of slip. So a literature says that if the extent of the facet joint effusion in MRI, it correlates significantly with the degree of slip in standing and supine position. Also, if there is a difference between left and right facet joint of effusion in left and right facet joint, that is also lead to difference in rotational translation of the vertebra during movements. This is Dr. Montoya also described this. Radiological predisposing factor for degenerative spondylolisthesis. It shows that if there is a presence of sacralization, or there is a change in L5 S1 disc space in MRI, or there is an intercrestal line, iliac crest line, there is no relationship of these things with the further progressment of the slip. Only there is an association of the sagittal orientation of the facet joint at L4 and L5 and degenerative listhesis at the center. So facet propagation, the sagittal orientation of the facet joint is much more important as compared to the sacralization and changes in L5, S1 or intercostal segments. Yes, obviously the spinopelvic parameter like lumbar lordosis and pelvic incidence, sacral slope and pelvic tip, we have to consider before planning or assessment. So literature says that decompression in lumbar degenerative spondylolisthesis, decompression and fusion surgery does not yield a clinical better outcome than decompression without alone surgery. These are comparable between two groups. And surgery appears to be a better conservative, surgery appears to be better than the conservative management. In ischemic listhesis, there is no good evidence in favor of that. In ischemic listhesis, surgery does not appear to be a better, does not yield a better outcome, but in degenerative listhesis, there is good evidence in favor of surgery in degenerative listhesis. Instrumental fusion and decompression are more successful than decompression alone is having a poor evidence. And what about the reduction? Yes, when there is a gross abnormality of spinopelvic parameter, we should take all these things into account. But study says the reduction and instrumentation of fusion does not appear to be a very successful than the instrumented fusion without reduction in ischemic and degenerative, ischemic or degenerative spondylolisthesis. So, North American Spine Society, this most recent updated guideline, that shows that 360 degree fusion where we do in TILIF or transforaminal lumbar intravertebral fusion, as compared to the posterolateral fusion, TILIF or OLIF or something, whatever 360 degree fusion, leads to better outcome. This evidence is insufficient in favor of 360 degree fusion. Flexible fusion improves the outcome. There is no evidence in favor of that. The role of reduction or bone graft substitute or autologous bone graft or minimally invasive versus open procedure, there is insufficient evidence for or against of all procedures. Decompression and fusion may be considered as a means to provide a long-term method for fusion, but symptomatically, these both have a similar outcome. So grade of recommendation is level C. And in degenerative spondylolisthesis, if you take it account the obesity or duration of symptom, some study says that if duration of symptom is more and the obese patient are very obese, this they will have a poor outcome after surgery, but it has an insufficient evidence as compared to the NAS. So addition of instrumentation, it increases the fusion rate, but it does not increase the clinical outcome. If there is a symptomatic single level degenerative spondylolisthesis of less than 30% without lateral foraminal stenosis, then only decompression will provide a good outcome. So it is a moderate level of recommendation. And use of injection and ancillary treatments like TENS, sort of diathermy, traction, dressing, these are the there is positive evidence for and against all these procedures. So there is no, you may or may not go for that. There is no sufficient evidence in favor of that. So to conclude, we need a careful assessment and evaluation before proceeding to the final treatment or surgery or conservative treatment according to the severity of the symptom, taking in radiology into the account and comorbidity of the patient. Most important, the psychosomatic patient, which will lead to a poor outcome. So thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, sir. We'll discuss after Bhavuk sir's talk, or any question from any panelist or any audience.
So we can discuss Bhavuk sir. Yes.
Bhavuk sir.
Yes, please. Hey, we can discuss after Bhavuk sir's talk, sir.
Yes, sir. Bhavuk sir.
Yes,
so
yes.
Next talk is from Bhavuk sir. He's additional professor at AIIMS Delhi, and he'll be talking on how do he does. He lives in a low-grade spondylitis diseases, and how does he plan his cases before going for a surgery? Bhavuk sir, over to you.
Vikram, you have to unshare.
Vikram sir, unshare kijiye apna slide PPT.
So my talk will be totally about all the practical thing, which how do I do it. So, and I think Dr. Upendra is going to show you the video. So our talks, they will be, you know, mostly, you know, they will be a mix and match sort of thing. So I usually prefer MIS for low grade spondylolisthesis if the patient is affording. And I use these sort of flexible tubes. This makes my life very easy. And MIS becomes very easy when you are using these sort of tubes. Coming to the open TLIF, which I think is the topic given to me, and still most of my patients they go opt for open TLIF because of the financial constraints. The preoperative workup usually include the detailed history examination. We all know, including neurological examination, X-ray. We have already discussed that I usually go for AP lateral flexion extension views. Whole spine X-rays, we look for sagittal balance if you are operating the patient. MRI, LS spine, we always go with the whole spine screening because we have picked up many cases in which we have found the associated anomalies. CT scan, we don't routinely do as a preoperative part of these things, but I do a CT scan if I'm suspecting a dysplastic pathology or if I'm suspecting that there's an adjacent segment instability or there's a hidden lysis at the proximal level. So these are the usual X-rays, the AP lateral and the flexion extension views you can see. And we measure all the angles in this thing. And then these are the whole spine X-rays, which we get, and we measure all this thing. I use SurgiMap software for measuring all the angles in this. These are the standard X-rays and the standard parameters which we use. So like for this suggestive case, in this case, the PI is usually the pelvic incidence is the most important angle. So we know that the whole of the lordosis should be equal to the PI. And the target lordosis, we know that the L4 to S1 is 2/3 of the whole lumbar lordosis. So this 2/3 of the whole lumbar lordosis is featured at the L5 S1. So in this patient, our target lordosis was 31 degrees intraoperatively. So this is the MRI, which you can see, nothing special, but we look for any facet hypertrophy, or we look for any extraforaminal disc. So we are very careful. If there's extraforaminal disc, then I usually look for the exiting nerve root as well, and I decompress it as well. CT scan, as I already said, if I'm suspecting instability or past lysis at the proximal level, or if there's a dysplastic type. So this is the how which we put all the things on the board in the theater, the pelvic incidence, all these parameters, and the target lordosis at that particular segment. So this is the position we standard the prone position we use, and the abdomen they should be hanging. One has to be very careful with this thing. We use this special table called proaxis table. You have to ensure that the C arm is freely movable between the AP and the lateral. The AP lateral movement, and you have to check it before draping. Then there are some questions, whether the lateral view should be taken from above or below. My preference is usually from the above, because sometimes not as in a low grade lysis, but if you are using the neuromonitoring or you know, on the other side, the urinary bag is there, or the other parameters, other things are there. So we usually prefer it from the above side. Drape, we use the standard draping techniques, and we use the this IO-bend drape for this thing. And we look at the preoperative X-ray, we look at the iliac crest level and the corresponding lumbar spine level, and then accordingly we mark our level on the patient. I use the then just after giving the skin incision, I use only cautery. And I just do the subperiosteal dissection with the help of the cautery only, monopolar cautery. And I usually go only up to the facet joint, and I don't go up to the, I don't expose the transverse process, because I believe that there is a entity described in literature called fusion disease, in which you, if you go lateral to the facet joint and you expose the whole of the transverse processes, then you denervate the whole of the muscles in that area. So we do not expose much lateral, and we just expose our entry point, and that's good enough for this thing. So then we confirm our level confirmation we do with the C-arm. So this is my first C-arm shot, which I take during the surgery, only the lateral view when I confirm on my level and my entry point first time. And then I just use the freehand technique. So for the, I start with the inferior screws, then I go for the proximal screws. And I always make special precaution to preserve the proximal most facet joint. Its capsule should be fully preserved. Then I osteotomize the inferior facet of the L5, if I'm doing it L5-S1. So the osteotomizing the inferior facet of L5 gives multiple advantages. First, it gives me a good bone graft. Second, it gives me a bilateral facetectomy, gives me a good, the space to achieve lordosis proximally. When I close it posteriorly, then it gives me good chances of approximating the lordosis. And third, it shows me my the facet and the pedicle through which I have to put the screw. So again, there are various advantages of doing the inferior facet of L5. And then this is just how I do my inferior facetectomy. And then I use the starter. And then the pedicle, all this, these are the standard steps which we use. And I usually look at the pars for guiding me. I go both in the medial lateral plane as well as in the craniocaudal plane, perpendicular to to the pars. And then I just by the feel, I enter into the pedicle. And then we do the sounding. We know that we have to check for the five walls, the medial, lateral, superior, inferior, and the floor. And then I don't use any tapping unless it is very hard sclerotic bone. Otherwise, I just after making my the pilot hole, I just put the screw straight away into the vertebra. I use everything on my table, including the reduction screws even for the low grade. If I am not able to achieve my positioning in this thing, then I prefer to use the reduction screws in this thing, especially in grade 2. Then once I am through with my screws, then I take my second shot to confirm whether these screws, they have been placed properly or not before proceeding further. This is my second shot. Then we contour the rod. And again, we contour the rod and we measure it as we have calculated it preoperatively, that how much lordosis we have to take. And then we just measure the angle of lordosis which has to be given on this thing. And then you see that I use these special retractors, which we call as the soft tissue protectors. And I just put it there, and there is no soft tissues coming up. And then we just put my rod and this thing, and I tighten my innies. And then we distract it to achieve the disc height as well as the reduction. And then we locked it. And this is how I do my, I take out the whole of the posterior elements in a single sweep movement. I will show you that how I do it. So I take out the interspinous ligament to superior inferiorly. And then I just put my corpse elevator below the facet joint. And I took out the whole of the lamina and the in a single piece. And this is the rattler coming out in single piece. And then I do my superior facetectomy. and then we enter into the disc space. Sometimes there is some sort of bone formation, and when if you hit bone, then it is always better to take a C-arm shot. Okay, whether is your where is exactly is your, you know, the shaver or the knife or the osteotome which you are this thing, because if it sometimes because of the trapezoidal shape, it you may damage the end plate also. So one has to be very, very careful. And then we use these serial shavers. I keep them in 1 mm increment, and I don't routinely look for the exiting nerve root. I just go lateral to the traversing nerve root, and I just try to be in line with the superior facet of the inferior vertebra, because the exiting nerve root, it passes just lateral to the at the disc space. Just lateral to the facet joint, just lateral to the superior facet of the inferior vertebra. So if you are medial or in line with the facet and at the disc level, then you are not in risk of endangering the exiting nerve root, especially if you are going for low grade listhesis. But when it comes to high grade listhesis, then you have to always expose the exiting nerve root, because it can be trapped in the callus, and also it can be very near to the disc space in high grade listhesis. And then we go for end plate preparation. I use these special, you know, you can see this is my shaver or the end plate preparator, which we use. This is like a cup and with serrated margins. And then I do thorough lavage before putting any bone graft. And then I put my my funnel into the disc space. And then I put graft into it, and I just packed it anteriorly. But one has to be very careful that you just sound it that the anterior annulus is intact or not before putting all this thing. Sometimes if you notice on the MRI, if there is an anterior disc herniation, then one has to be very careful that there could be an anterior defect. And one has to be very careful with while putting your disc forceps inside the in the disc. And first, always feel that the annulus is intact before taking any bite of disc from the disc space. And then we go for the cage placement. Again, the choice of cages, they, it depends upon the surgeon, but I usually use peak cages because they help in assessing me a good, you know, fusion post-operatively. Now there could be an argument that the peak cage, they are not so bone friendly, but we have not encountered any problem with peak cages so far. The titanium cages, they are also good. They also work. These peak cages, they also work. If your end plate preparation is good, if you're putting your bone graft back anteriorly, then these all sort of cases, I have not encountered any problem with any of these cages. The only thing is that I don't use banana cages now. I straight away go for these bullet cages. They are very easy to put, and there is no special preparation required. And this thing, like you can see here, that I just straight away go for, and I try to put as large footprint I can use. The only problem cited with these bullet cages is that sometimes they can backtrack through the same thing. So for this, I have not seen, I've just seen one case in my practice, but for even to obviate this problem, I always make these cage horizontal once I put this thing. So I use this L punch, you can see here, and I just put it at the edge of the cage and just hammer it, make it a little bit horizontal. And then I use a T punch and make it further horizontal. And I try to place my cage as anteriorly as possible, because that helps me in achieving the lordosis. So you can see that I put the cage almost obliquely, and then I make it horizontally. So this thing. So there is almost nil chances of getting it backtracked to the same defect which we have created. Then we put the second rod again with the help of the soft tissue retractors, and this is the final C-arm shot which we take. So there are total 4 X-rays which are usually required when you are doing a TLIF, especially for a low grade listhesis. And then you finally tighten your knees, and if you have used reduction screws, then you this thing. Then we do lavage and then put a drain. I always use a drain for a day, and then we close it in layers and we do the dressing. And we usually make the patient to sit in the stand same day evening, and we mobilize them next day, and usual stay is 2 to 3 days. And after wound inspection and everything is this thing, then patient usually goes home the second day. Thank you.
Uh, How, sir? There might be a lot of questions from you because these are the basis of this talk. So can you tell me first, how do you decide the size of the cage? As large as a cage can be very subjective. How do you confirm that this is the cage which I am going to put in?
So when I'm preparing my end plates, so at that time I look for the shaver, it starts biting into the end plate, and I just put one size bigger than that.
Okay. And how much preparation you do for end plate? You try to scrap off all the end plate, or you just create slightly raw area to put a cage in?
Just create a little bit raw area. There is no disc, this thing. One has to be very careful, especially with osteoporotic bone, that you are not going to the cage, into the end plates. Otherwise, you will be ending into the cage subsidence, and you know the cage will go into the sink, into the bone.
Dr. Babu, how many cages you use and in the TLIF? One or two?
Only one.
Only one. And plus bone graft?
Yes.
You are told in the presentation, you are using SurgiMap software.
Yes.
So I would like to know about something about the SurgiMap software.
So SurgiMap software is free to use. You can Google it and you can download it into your software, and you just import your x-rays, and you can measure all the angles. So you just have to define where the femoral head is, where the L1 is, where this thing is, and then it can just give you all the angles. It's very easy to use.
Okay. Thank you.
One question. Sir, do you measure the, after putting the cage, do you measure intraoperatively the lumbar lordosis you achieve?
Yes, I forgot to put that slide. So we have, in our SIAM itself, we have the measuring capability. Otherwise, you can download SurgiMap into your iPhone or the Samsung, and you can just take the shot, and then you can also measure it in lumbar lordosis.
Thank you, sir. And any particular step you take to prevent save the dorsal root ganglion? Or
ganglion of which this thing? I don't expose exiting nerve root. I don't even expose the exiting nerve root.
Okay, sir. Sir.
Yes.
Sir, you only rely on the contouring of the rod for the achieving lordosis, or do you use special expandable cages or something to achieve the lordosis?
Prabhat, I told you that I always do bilateral facetectomies. Beforehand, and this is the biggest this thing, and then when you put a large cage and this thing, then this is sufficient enough, and then finally you just close your you compress posteriorly, then you can achieve any amount of lordosis. So my usual cage which I put is between 12 to 15 mm.
So sir, nowadays some hyperlordotic cages are in the market, and Western people are propagating it, and now they are shifting toward the ALIF to restore the lordosis in L5S1 and L4L5. So just by doing TLIF, how much we can achieve? But their literature show that we can't achieve 35 degree or 55 degree lordosis through by doing posterior surgery.
Prabhat, I am yet to come across any case in which I was not able to restore the lumbar lordosis, which I intend to do during the surgery. So when I will feel that, then I will think of this thing. But till now, I have whatever lumbar lordosis we measured, and we use this thing. Regarding expendable cages, I am not a good fan of them because I always feel that when you expand, then the bone graft is not there at the edges. So, it's just a space there.
And sir, in osteoporotic patients, the end plates are very weak. So, they are saying that when we use these bullet cages, they used to sink. So, what's your opinion on that, sir?
That's why you have to place them as anteriorly as possible, because there is an area of end plate which is relatively stable, or relatively hard, this thing. So you have to place them anteriorly, and I make them horizontal. This cage.
So in that case, the banana cage will be more efficient, I think, than bullet cages.
So I have felt, when you insert these banana cages, they keep on moving, or they create more problem for me. So these bullet cages, they are more friendly. Maybe Dr. Pendra can tell if any.
No, sir. Actually, sir, the patient, the surgeons who are doing OLIF, they usually used to say, we used to push large cages from one end of the end plate to other end of the end plate. There are no chances of sinking. That's why.
Prabhat, regarding the OLIF, there are ample studies now which have shown that they do not offer any advantage regarding in terms of lumbar lordosis restoration.
Okay.
The only advantage of using OLIF or the lateral lumbar interbody fusion is that they help in coronal deformity correction as compared to TLIF. Now, there is an ample evidence and it is proven in literature.
And sir, in all the patients, you go for interbody fusion or in you opt for a PLF, only posterolateral fusion?
In elderly patient and again, very osteoporotic patients, then I only go for PLF.
Okay, in comorbid patient and this patient.
Maybe Dr. Pendra can tell about bullet cages and this thing, banana cages.
See, basically, each of us evolve in our own practices. So to be very frank, I admit that we hardly use cages in our setup now. So most of the cases, you know, like where we have to use the cages is a revision surgery where we don't have bone graft, not sufficient amount of facet or the lamina. Only there we are using the cage, and we are okay with any of the cages. And only one thing we observed with peak cages, especially with our experience with the cervical spine, is the peak cage had a few amount of end plate osteolysis in the cervical one. So we haven't come across in the lumbar one, but to be on the safer side, if we use, sometimes we try to use the titanium now. Both it is economically better for them, and we don't see any reason to use peak cage now. Otherwise, I have very little experience with cages now. To be very frank, now one of our residents 2 years he was telling me that he has not seen cages. So you know, absolutely, we have come across like we don't put cages at all in any setup now.
To Bhauk sir and sir, so a long-standing low back pain of about say 10 years, 5 years, you are distracting. They are putting a larger case. Any incidence of cord stretching or chances of postoperative neurological deficit due to stretching the cord after doing a TLIF with the cage? How do you ensure that cord doesn't get stretched?
See, first of all, at this level, there is no cord. There is only dura in the nerve root.
Sorry, dura.
So, whatever, you know, the amount of distraction which we are doing, it is not going to have any effect on this thing.
See, another thing, what Bauk does is he does bilateral facetectomies. You have bilateral foraminal decompression there only. So, the very idea of you putting a cage and distracting is if you are not decompressing the other side. So you want an indirect decompression of the other foramen. So if you are doing a direct decompression of both the foramen, there is no necessity for you to actually distract to decompress. So you can easily have a direct decompression and you can actually compress to get a lordosis as Bauk does.
Sir, how often do you inspect the opposite side foramen after preparing disc space?
So if the patient has symptoms on both sides, then I always inspect the both side nerve roots. And if the patient, so I usually go from the symptomatic side. So if the patient has symptoms on the other side, I always look at the other side nerve root as well.
Bauk sir, I just have one small question. It was a great technique that you have shown. In that you you put one side screws and then you distract the rod. And then you go for the anterior.
To reduce the listlessness.
Okay, so does it have any bearing on the size of the cage when you are, because when we are reaming the anterior end plates and we look for that gritty sensation of the final reamer, that so that we decide the height of the cage. If we have distracted it, so that gritty sensation will come at a higher distractor rather than, or you release it intra-op while doing the anterior reaming.
So you saw that I always put the rod in the desired lordosis.
Yeah.
So, you know, so I will not be getting much this thing. So I will, my distraction will be occurring as per the natural lordosis in that particular segment.
Okay.
But the only thing is that if there is a fish mouth deformity, then one has to be very careful in that case. Otherwise, there is not much distraction. And the thing is that we are fixing it in the desired amount of lordosis.
Yeah.
Okay. Fine. Sure.
How much reduction you achieve, sir?
In low grade, 100%.
Yeah.
One question, sir. How do you judge on preoperatively? How you judge that after positioning the patient in extended position, it will reduce Is there any radiological criteria?
I don't look at that. If I just take the X-ray intraoperatively, and if the patient is not, it has not reduced, then again I do all the releases. Usually, when you do facetectomies and this thing, then they usually reduce. And once you have taken out disc, you have taken out both the facet, then there is no reason that it should not reduce.
So you told that does not reflect the paraspinal muscle from the transverse up to the transverse processes.
Yes.
So, sir, as I remember, the only transverse process is the only landmark which remain intact in listhesis cases. So that is the most reliable landmark to put the screws. So give sir some tips and tricks how you put the screws in hypertrophic facets.
So my entry point is where the superior articular facet joins the pars.
Okay, so facets are very hypertrophied in the listhesis cases or in the degenerative cases. So how you judge that it is the which is the junctional area?
So the facet joint hypertrophy is always at the inferior one. And I am taking out the inferior facet. I can clearly see there.
Pankaj Khandelwal or Upendra sir, any take on L5 neurological deficit in a listhesis case, the post TLIF? L5 is slightly notorious for getting neuropraxia or sometimes a deficit in L5 distribution.
It is basically in high-grade listhesis. You won't get those neuropraxias or traction in a low-grade listhesis.
Okay. Any questions?
So there has been one question from Dr. Syed in the chat box. Like, if you are not able to reduce the listhesis completely, is there any trick for that?
Yes, if sometimes, you know, in very, you know, one or two cases, if it's difficult, then what I do, I put my osteotome inside the disc space and I just lift the L5 up using the S1 as a fulcrum.
Usually in low grade listhesis, it should never be a problem. What you can do is when you have put polys there, you can fix the lower, that is the L5 poly in an L4, L5 listhesis in slight extension so that you can reduce L4 over that once you tighten the rod over the L5. So otherwise, I don't think you should be cracking your head even if you don't get 1 or 2 mm reduction. That's not such an important thing. Once you get reduction and you can do a fusion, I think that should be okay.
Thank you.
Again, the question is coming about the size of cage. Pankaj Khandelwal, sir, can you say how do you decide your size of cage?
Okay. Avinash, I just wanted to again echo with Dr. Upendra said just now. The aim of surgery in low-grade spondy is not reduction, for sure. It's all about decompression. If it doesn't reduce, it's okay. It's a high grade where you are aiming for reduction. You know, we can have an argument whether you want to reduce or not in high grade, not in low grade. So reduction should not be the aim in low grade spondy for sure. Now coming on to the size of the cage which you need to put, I think it's very much subjective and intraoperatively how snug is your sizer. So first with the scrapers itself, you can come to know where you get the nice gritting feeling of the end plates, and then you put the sizer. I would go for 10, 12. It's just okay depending on the level and depending on the disc height preoperatively. So again, it's for me predominantly I decided intraoperatively based on the size of the sizer which can be negotiated.
How, sir, any use of seeing the proximal and the distal disc space to know the accurate sizer what we have put in trial, basically?
No, I don't go for the adjacent disc size.
Sir, what's your experience or opinion regarding MIS, MIS and OPP?
For low grade listhesis, I already said that if patient is affording, then I go for MIS surgery.
Okay.
Okay. But if the patient has stenosis, then I always go for open one. I don't go for MIS.
If there is some neurology, then I think
again open. Again open.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Prabhat, I think you are muted. You are asking something, but you are muted.
Say, an obese patient, give us some tips and tricks for putting pedicle screws, because paraspinal muscles are hanging over there, then, or get the angles.
Yes, so in obese patients, we have seen that if you plan for your traditional entry point, as you said, the transverse process, you look for the transverse process, pars and the superior articular facet, where you are, they all the three meet. In those cases, we have seen that the lateral cutout chances are more, because you will not be able to angulate it more medially, because all of the muscles, they are pushing your hand towards the medial and you tend to go laterally. So in that cases, we have seen that the medial entry point is much better because you can achieve the required trajectory.
Okay.
Bikram sir, one question is there, what conservative management you opt for in a low grade dysesthesia when you are deciding that you are not going to operate it? Bikram sir?
Yes. Conservative management offers a very good result in case of if you are talking about a degenerative dysesthesia or lytic dysesthesia. If there is an acute fracture, you can go for a conservative treatment. Conservative treatment by bracing, cast immobilization, period of rest, abstinence from the sports activity works tremendously in case of a acute pars fracture or defect. In case of low grade degenerative spondylolisthesis, you can go for this conservative management until and unless there is a severe symptom or excessive neurogenic claudication is there. You can comfortably go for conservative treatment. Literature says this treatment holds equally good with surgeon.
Upendra sir, what do you prescribe to the patient? Which exercises do you ask for if you are going for conservative
in a low-grade pain? Standing exercise.
Radiculopathy. Upendra sir?
Basically, regarding the decision making, there are two things we need to remember. We operate for a progressive claudication, which is not responding to the conservative thing. So basically, conservative can be anything for people. We openly tell it to our patients. Either you can take no treatment, you can do your normal walks and your exercises. Yeah. You can go in for even Ayurvedic massages. You can go in for massages. So any of the conservative management where the disease process by itself has a good natural history works. So there is no hard and fast rule or any evidence that, particular exercise works better. So I don't believe in that. So basically, if the patient is not able to manage her normal activities and the walking distance is coming down, that's a clear cut indication for me for the surgery.
Usually, what we, in case of a lytic listhesis, we usually avoid the extension exercise, because extension exercise aggravates the disease more. So only core strengthening exercise, extension exercise is to be prevented.
Okay, sir. Next talk by Upendra, sir. So he will be surgically, he is showing a video that how does he manage his low-grade listhesis. And as Saraj already told that he is not going for cages so oftenly now, so he'll tell how does he does without the cages. Sir, over to you.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Avinash. Thank you, Prabhat. So, I think just, yeah. So, I think Bauk has made my talk very easy. So, what I'll be doing is I'll directly go to one of the cases. I mean, this was one of the case where I had the video, so I'm taking it. It's a grade one listhesis at L3, L4, and more of a stenosis. So here, this is a 58-year-old male with right-sided foot drop since 2 weeks. So obviously, he requires surgery. Now, I want you to actually see the axial sections, how the facet joints have actually encroached upon the canal. and you actually need a good bony decompression here for achieving our goal of surgery. So for the residents and graduates, normally we see this image of lumbar spine, right? So we start believing that, you know, our foramen will be like this. When we go in, we'll have so much space and everything will be like this when we start doing surgery. But it's important that you start seeing, you know, cadavers where there are degenerated spines. This is actually a photo from our AIMS cadaver, you know, section. I think the dissection section where we have so many cadavers with the different stages of degeneration you can see there. And you can see here, as Bhavuk was telling, when you have degeneration, the inferior articular process actually comes down quite a bit. So if you do not take out this inferior articular process, your even the entry for your you know, pedicle screw, everything goes haywire. The other thing I want you to start appreciating is that the superior articular facet actually presses on your exiting nerve root. So if you see that in the preoperative images, the disc is completely worn out and there is, the facet that is actually going down, you should be aware that even the opposite side, exiting nerve root might be compressed. So you need to decompress. So these things we need to plan before we go in so that we decompress not only the traversing nerve root, but also the exiting nerve root, depending on what case it is. So more of stenosis, more of degeneration, we need to address the superior articular facet also. So what we do is, like, if it is a unilateral decompression, obviously we can do it up with osteotomizing the inferior articular process and the superior articular process, a small bit you can take out to get entry into the disc space. Now here, as you have seen, we have to take out both sides. So if we start doing both sides still, if what will be left will be only the spinous process here. So instead of that, what we are doing in most of our cases is just join both the TILFs. So you do a complete horizontal osteotomy where the whole of your lamina comes out. So this is just like if you have a pars fracture already, you can take out the operculum completely as Bhavuk showed. So this we have been doing without any problems in our setup. I'll just be showing this case only. Here we did L3, L4, L5, S1 pedicle screws and did three laminectomies. For orientation, this is your cranial side. You can see the lamina. We have taken out the spinous process here. So I'll just start the video. This is a 2x video. I've just, for the sake of time, I have fastened it. So we start by cutting the pars along with the lamina here. You can see the direction of the osteotome which goes there. Once the pars is cut, you can see that the lamina moves quite nicely there. So the advantage here is the ligamentum will be protecting you. So you don't go completely to the cranial aspect there. So once you have cut, the whole of your lamina comes out like this. So initially, yeah, it might be scary for people to do this, but it's quite safe. You can see the ligamentum flavum completely intact there. You can see the dura there. So the above portion, that is the cranial most portion of the lamina, we leave it intact there because that is the portion that is at intimate contact with the dura. So you just go below that, so you have an island here. So once you have osteotomized both the things, usually the lamina comes off completely unless your facet is completely fused there. So in case your facet is not giving way, you might have to loosen it up before you can take out the lamina like this. So once you take out the lamina, you can see this is the island of bone that will be there in between. So many a times what happens is once you are trying to take out the lamina, the ligamentum flavum also completely comes off. It depends on how much of chronic degeneration there is. Sorry, it went back, I think. Yeah, now you can see that. So here you can see there is no ligamentum flavum at all. It came out with the complete lamina there. Now, for a complete central decompression, you need to take out this island of bone. So you just thin it out on both the sides there. Once you thin it out on both the sides, you can use your upcuts to completely cut off the one side of lamina there. So once you are able to go there, and you know this is actually the entrance zone of your root there, you are decompressing that portion also. This is the superior articular facet. So once you cut open there, usually it flips off. You can see I'm just showing it you with the upcut because it is so loose there. So it completely comes off. So you have a complete central decompression there. So similarly, wherever you have that central small lamina which is actually left behind, you can take it out. So once you have done this, you have a complete central decompression. The only thing you need to be careful is in a revision case, this might be difficult. We'll have adhesions. More often in a nascent case, a virgin case, you won't have any of these adhesions. So you can go ahead and do this pretty comfortably. So next thing is we need to decompress the foramen. As you saw in these images, this patient had a significant foraminal stenosis. So we need to take out this superior articular facet so that the foraminal, the exiting root is decompressed. As you can see here, it will be compressed. Now, just to show you, the superior articular facet is completely covering the whole of your foramen here. Once we take out, you can see the nerve root where it will be placed. So the amount of hypertrophy of these facets almost, touching the above screw there. So here again, you will have the bleeders. You need to control it with bipolar. I think in just a second, I'll be showing you the exiting nerve root. That is the pars left behind. I just took out a bit. So you can see the root going there. I'll be showing you the inferior border of that. Yeah, that is the inferior border of the root. Now you can imagine how the superior articular facet was actually completely covering that. Now, many a times, if the stenosis is very severe, you may not be even able to put your upcut over it without crushing this nerve root. So taking out with an osteotome, we have found that is much safer when we do a severe foraminal stenosis. So once you have done the foraminal stenosis, next thing is to get into the disc space that I think Bauk has shown it quite nicely. I'll just show it to you in one of our other videos where we did a TLIF. Here you can see this is the exiting nerve root. This is the traversing nerve root. This is your safe zone. So you need to cauterize all your epidurals there. You can put a gel foam and keep it there. I usually use a knife to know where my openings are, so I can know exactly where the lip of the osteophyte will be. Otherwise, as Bauk was telling, it is very easy to get into the end plate. So exactly you should know where the lip of the osteophyte is there to get into. I usually use these 7 mm osteotomes and get into the disc space and use them as shavers. So I do not use the shavers normally. So these osteotomes itself, they clear up the end plates there. And then of course, we use the curettes to get into the end plates and do a good end plate preparation. Because we usually put the bone grafts, we make sure that we prepare the end plate completely. We get into the other side also with these curettes and then start putting the bone graft after we have completely done the end plate preparation. So this is the post-operative x-rays. You can see that we have put on both the levels, we have put the bone grafts there, and we could achieve lordosis with these bone grafts itself. So the operative time is around 2.5 hours. The blood loss is around 650 ml. The patient is made to walk the same evening. That's the norm we follow. And for this patient, fortunately, even the food drop improved at around 6 weeks. And majority of the cases where we have put bone graft also, we have not observed too much of, subsidence or kyphosis. Most of these patients have good bone stock and fusion occurs quite nicely. Even in cases of high-grade listhesis, most of the times we get away with bone grafts only and we get good fusion there. So I think I'll stop at this. So we'll have some more time for discussion. I think I'll stop sharing here. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So you don't look for this height maintenance, that it is achieving its normal height or not?
See, the basic goals of your surgery, you need to understand. See, it's not that you have to recreate your disc space. The idea is to have a good decompression of your foramen. So now if you start seeing where the nerve is compressed, one is the traversing nerve root, which is getting compressed by the superior articular facet. That you directly decompress by your upcuts. Now, the second is your exiting nerve roots. If you feel that you're not seeing the opposite exiting nerve root and you want to achieve an indirect decompression, then you need to recreate your disc height. If you're doing a superior articular facetectomy and you are seeing the nerve root completely naked with your eyes, absolutely no necessity for recreating your disc height. Instead, if you actually compress, it will allow more, the fusion will be much more easier. So we need to see what our goals are and then, try to recreate the disc space if you require.
Sir, if this case fails, just say if this case fails, it goes under pseudoorthosis or patient comes for any recurrence. So, sir, since we have removed all the landmarks to raise the paraspinal muscles, so for revision surgery, so do you go for anterior in such cases or you go posterior?
No, I didn't understand the revision.
Sir, if you have to revise this case for any reason, so you will go for posterior or anterior as there is no landmark left.
Yeah, let me put it in practically. So what is the revision surgery we will be doing here? If the screw fails, the rod fails, and there is a pseudarthrosis. So there you can actually go in from behind itself. You can have your screw landmarks, which are already there. So you can actually, either the screw has broken or the rod has broken, you can re-instrument it. Because this is the area where you are comfortable with. From anterior, if you are reducing without seeing what is happening posteriorly, where the screws or rods have broken, you anyway have to go posteriorly. So I do not see any reason why you will have to go anteriorly when you want to do a revision case.
So don't you think that the spine is pretty unstable while you're removing all the parts of both sides without fixing the rod on the contralateral side? So spine becomes a little unstable while operating intra.
So you need to see where is the instability. Yes, as you pointed out, there will be quite unstable conditions where you will see the spine moving. At that time, we actually put one of the rods before using the osteotome. So we don't want to transmit the force of osteotome to the neural structures. So that you can decide based on case to case. So if there is instability you are seeing, you just have to put one of the rods and then start doing your decompression.
Okay, sir. So we'll discuss after Pankaj Khandelwal's talk. So Pankaj sir, can you start your talk, please?
Okay, so let me share the screen now. I've been asked to present interesting cases in low-grade spondies, and unfortunately, there are not many interesting cases in low-grade spondy. had it been high grade, I still agree that
next time it will be more interesting one, next lectures.
So I'm just taking you through my case examples and some of the complications. So that will be the main idea of the presentation today.
So share is, yes.
Can you see my presentation now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So I'll take you through my experience so far. The outline is going to be, I'll be briefly talking about instability. I know the previous speakers have spoken about it, but my experience, interesting cases, complications which we had, I'll be briefly touching upon which is the best treatment modality, surgical treatment modality for low-grade spondees and role of MIST LIF. I'll be, this is basically the literature, what the latest literature says. So we all know that we have moved on from posterolateral to instrumented posterolateral to PLIF and now TLIF and latest would be MIST LIF and God knows LLIF and XLIF, whatever. There are plenty of things which have come in the market now for interbody fusion. This is the concept of instability, which I want to reinforce with the audience that it could be sagittal plane translation. So any translation which is more than 4.5 mm is not good in dynamic films. And similarly, rotation in case you see, and rotation could be, could vary from level to level. So for L1, L2, L2, L3, L3, 4, more than 15 degrees, then dynamic film is unstable. And you go to L5S1, if it is more than 25 degrees, it's an unstable situation. This is our experience so far for low-grade spondees. Nearly 42 patients we have done. Females were more than men, and most of them were in the age group of 40 to 60. Looking at the distribution so far, most of them were at L4-5, followed by L5-A1, and a few of them were at L3-4 also. These were the complications which came across. I'm going to show few of the complications also, which we came across. Dural tear, yes, definitely yes. Migration of cage was there in one. Unfortunately, we never had any neurological complication in these patients. And if you look at most of the functional outcomes, they do phenomenally good. They whether it's ODI or VAS, or you look at any of the domain of SF-36 questionnaire, most of them improve with surgery. So this was one of the interesting cases, young female, lot of instability pain, her activity of daily living was restricted, high ODI, and this is how she came with characteristic instability catch. She had two level lysis, as you guys can appreciate. It's a isthmic kind of a lysis, and these are dynamic films, again, very unstable situation here. So yes, we did a two-level TLIF for this patient, as I think most of the panelists and the faculty would have planned. And this is like a five-year follow-up of the patient. Patient holding well, doing good. I preferably use cage, and I use peak cage for my TLIFs. Another case. This elderly gentleman who came to us with pain, low backache, not only low backache, but also neurogenic claudication. These are the dynamic films. This was done a single level TLIF, and this is like two or three years of follow-up. I'm not too sure, but you can nicely see how the posterolateral graft looks like. Yeah, so this is the good position of the cage. It's quite in the midline, and it's fairly in the center or anterior, I would say, in the lateral film. This is another gentleman who came to us with the lysis of L5-1. It's a, you can see the break in the pars. It was a lighter kind of a lysis. And these are the MRI sections, which you can see. Not much of finding, but instability pain. The indications, I think, more or less stay the same. You don't jump for surgery in spondyl lysis. You try, you exhaust all kind of conservative treatment. If they don't do better, then you are left with very little option but to fuse that segment. So we did a monosegmental fixation here again. You can see the position of the cage, and it's kind of, it's these the CT scans are the follow-up CT scans, and you can see how bone is forming through the cage. Now coming on to literature, I'll just quickly go on to where do we stand, you know, whether there were a few questions, whether TLF is really required or PLF is good enough. So if you look at this study, PLF definitely had significantly lower operating time. However, the leg pain or HQ, all those functional outcomes or health-related functional outcomes, blood loss, infection rate, there was no significant difference. On the other hand, TLIF was superior to posterolateral fusion with regards to fusion, which was translated to better functional outcome in ODI and back pain. Now, this is also an interesting paper which says that if you do a PLIF, there is a significant high chances of reoperation. So you think that PLIF could be cost effective, but it may not be. Okay, this is another interesting article. I think previous speakers spoke about it. And now this is about TLIF versus PLIF. So if you look at TLIF versus PLIF or the posterior lumbar interbody fusion, the clinical satisfaction and fusion more or less stays the same. However, TLIF is superior to PLIF when it comes to blood loss, surgical time, and most importantly is the injury to the neural structures and dural tear. So minimal handling with TLIF, and thus it shows. I think this is again repetition of the previous speaker who just spoke. So surgery is surgery versus conservative treatment. The recommendation is surgery is better. When it comes to instrumented fusion with reduction versus without reduction, clinically there may not be different benefits. So again, once again, low grade spondylolisthesis, your aim should not be reduction. It has to be decompression and restoration of the lordosis and maybe fusion. So decompression remains the main goal of surgery in these patients, and maybe stabilizing the and taking care of the instability. Yeah, so next comes instrumented fusion with decompression versus decompression alone. In degenerative spondylolisthesis, where you think the spine is already going for auto-stabilization, some of them can talk about decompression alone, especially if there is a static slip. But there is a dynamic slip, don't hesitate from doing fusion. So fusion is definitely recommended. Interspinous process spices, I think we just skip this. Yeah, when compared to systemic spondylolisthesis, definitely, as I was telling you in the previous study also, TLIF definitely scores higher when compared to. Yeah, and then next is the standalone interbody fusion for interior decompression. May be considered as an option, but nothing is good, nothing is better than a direct decompression. Because most of the spondylolisthesis patients, apart from instability, most of them majorly come for the neurological symptoms. And as a surgeon, I feel much more comfortable in directly decompressing the neural structures rather than relying on the indirect decompression. This is one of the interesting cases which I just wanted to share with you guys. A 55-year-old male patient, neurogenic claudication, walking distance hardly 100 meters. Progressive decrease in walking distance, in fact, I would say. LCS with some segmental instability. We offered him surgery, and this was the TLIF we did. This was nearly, I think, again, as most of the faculty previously said, it's always preferable to have graft initially put before the cage. So that's called a sentinel grafting. And you put the tricortical graft in front of the cage before you shove in, you push the cage in. And I understand that we made out that the cage was slightly posterior, but we were just keeping this patient under follow-up. His neurological symptoms got better. And look at the CT scan in coronal plane, the cage is perfectly in midline. Yeah, while it was just touching the posterior border of the in the sagittal plane. And as the it had it, the patient came with this kind of x-ray. Surprisingly, the patient does not have any neurological symptoms. Though we offered him surgery and we said, I'm going to revise your cage. The patient has refused surgery so far. He's under follow-up and doesn't have too much of doesn't have neurological symptoms right now, and we're just keeping him in close follow up. So this was one interesting case which I saw. I thought I should share with you people. Yeah, when coming to MI still live, I totally agree. Low grade spondylolisthesis with one-sided radiculopathy or one-sided foraminal stenosis is one of the best indication for MI still live. The extended indication of MI still live could be a central stenosis. A lot of people who are well trained in minimal invasive can do over the top, and they can do this. They can take care of the central stenosis also. But for me, it is a foraminal stenosis or a foraminal disc with a low grade spondy would be a perfect indication for MI still live. So there are plenty of systems which you want to use. There are plenty, and most of them are very friendly. I would preferably say that it's purely on surgeon's prerogative. It is his choice, whatever implant he's comfortable with. And there are plenty of options in the market to have to exercise your minimal invasive techniques. So this was one L5S1 listhesis, low back pain patient. Neurogenic claudication, could not walk. You can see the MRI axial cuts. There's plenty of stenosis happening there, and she was managed with the MIS, and we could fairly restore the height of the L5S1 disc, and she's doing well with the TLIF. I think much has been spoken about how MIS TLIF is better than open TLIF, conventional TLIF. We all know the muscle damage is less, blood loss is less, length of hospital stay is less. It's a cost-saving procedure, especially if the length of stay is less. And it is definitely a safe alternative for obese patients. If you try doing open surgeries in obese patients, you have to give a big incision. You're struggling a lot. Your muscle is pushing your trajectory every time. And as the previous Bhavuk just spoke about how it can lead to lateral breach. So that could be there. So MIS takes care of all those things. Well, complications definitely are there with minimal invasive. It has a long learning curve. You come across hemorrhage. Dural tear could be really nightmare if you're doing it with MIS. And yes, you definitely don't have a very good tactile feel with the MIS, and visceral injuries are common. Implant failure could be there. Proximal facet violation, I think, is one of the thing which is most talked about in MIS TLIF. I think advent of navigation, radiation has gone down. Radiation is otherwise a big concern with MIS. So I think most of the surgeons are really worried whether MIS complication rates are so high. Should we go ahead with this? And this was a systematic review which I came across, and overall it says that the patient rates are, you may come across complications, but once you're through with that curve, learning curve, your complications are going to be as less as a traditional open technique. So this is one patient, 70-year-old male. Oh yeah, this is one interesting case I thought I'll share with you. Yeah, so this was again a high BMI patient, L4-5 listhesis with LCS, right side symptoms predominantly. I thought he was the best candidate for MIS. And these are the MRIs which we have, and you can appreciate right-sided symptoms and right-sided disc, foraminal stenosis, fascial hypertrophy. And we offered him MIS TLIF. And as our luck had, we came across bleeding during the surgery, and we had to put in our patties. And during the whole process, we were about to close the wound, and suddenly the staff nurse said the patty count was less. And then we had to re-explore. We had to find that patty. He was fat patient. Everything was going wrong that day. And unfortunately, during the whole process, the proximal screw came out. And that was one thing which I was like, how are we going to manage now? And but somehow we just came out with the unilateral fixation, And these are the follow-ups you can see. And now, though there is some case substance we can appreciate, but there's some nice bone formation happening here. He's holding on well, and I'm just keeping my fingers crossed for this patient. Let's see, he recently visited us, and functionally he's doing good. And he doesn't have any instability also. So touch wood, we may get a CT scan to see the fusion in the future. Okay, so MI is an open technique. I think there are conflicting evidence. You can go for either of it. Overall, in conclusion, TLIF is any day superior to PLIF or PLF in management of surgical management of low-grade spondylolisthesis. You can give a try for MIS TLIF. The world is divided, but if you are good in MIS, you can pass on the benefit to the patient. And remember, the complications are going to be the same. Thank you. These are my acknowledgements. I thank all my residents who work hard for me. Thank you.
Sir, to you and Upinder, sir, how does your decision making changes if you're doing a two level or three level listhesis?
I'm sorry, let me unshare it.
Upinder, sir?
I mean, I didn't get your question.
How does your decision making change if you're going to do two level or three level spondy?
I mean, it's the same. So as I showed you, it was three level low grade spondylolisthesis. You have to decompress as you decompress for a single level spondylolisthesis, and you have to stabilize that level. Sometimes, yes, if the above disc is not that much disrupted and you just get a bit of instability and you are doing that level to prevent an adjacent level segment, we do not do a T-lift there. So that way we just do a posterolateral fusion in the above segment to prevent a further add-on phenomenon. Otherwise, it's the same. Wherever the compression is, we go ahead, decompress and stabilize it.
Pankaj,
I'm sorry, you want to say it's you are at high risk of neurological complications if you put more cages?
Yes,
with every levels you are increasing your complications, whether it is neurological complication, whether it's because the surgical time is increasing. So definitely chances of risk of complications go up if you go 2, 3, 4 levels. That's obvious, but in case you have to do it is an unstable situation, you have to go for TLIF. You can't leave that segment. I would agree with Dr. Pendra that yes, sometimes for the proximal level, if there is just stenosis, not much of instability, I also will go for just for a postlateral fusion at the topmost level. But otherwise, TLIF for 2-3 levels is very safe, and it's good.
Dr. Pankaj, this is Dr. Verma from Bhopal. One of your slide, showing unilateral fixation.
Yes.
I didn't understand this.
Oh, yes. That was a complication, Dr. Verma. That was a complication which we came across.
Yeah.
I do not recommend unilateral fixation in while going for TLIF. However, yes, there's plenty in literature where they say clinical outcomes is equal whether you do a unilateral or bilateral.
Sure.
This was a complication. I just wanted to show that, I wanted to share with you guys the complications, and maybe this was an interesting case which I had to share.
Okay,
Pankaj sir, how to look for exiting nerve root? Because Bhauk sir told he doesn't look for exiting nerve root. Sometimes he's saying that sometimes it's difficult to look for exiting nerve root. Any tips and tricks to see exiting nerve root?
See, it's basically again the necessity of it. So if you want, you can look for it. The pathology says if there is a good amount of foraminal space there, you do not have to actually go behind the superior articular facet and you have to see the exiting nerve root. So you will know if there is good amount of foraminal space, you can just go ahead to the disc, just pulling your traversing nerve root and do the TLIF. So it's not a hard and fast rule in every case that you have to do this and you have to do that. So each spine case is different. If we study the images and what is required to decompress, I think then we will know what needs to be done. So it's not necessary that you have to see the exiting nerve root in every case. No.
Dr. Gurdeep, say something.
I agree with Upendra, sir. I mean, looking for the exiting nerve root for me is more of, I mean, necessary when I'm doing a lytic listhesis, where I'm concerned that the lytic rattler could be compressing on the exiting nerve root. So I'm very meticulous with my exiting nerve root decompression when I'm dealing with a lytic listhesis. So when I'm doing a degenerate decompression and I have confirmed on the pre-op MRI that it is the central canal which is more compressed. So I do not make a special effort to look for the exiting nerve root, but I do put a probe in and check whether there is enough space for the exiting nerve. But I don't like visualize the exiting nerve.
Now, if you look at theoretically, the Campbell triangle is, you cannot go into the interbody area unless you have seen the exiting root. So again, but I agree with the faculty that it's a very personal choice. Some people, it was, you know, it's something like spondylosis is not like this, where the traversing root is affected. You have to check your exiting root also. Especially where there's a pars defect, there's a lot of fibrosis there. It is the exiting root which would be compressed. Yes, I agree. You are doing indirect decompression and all those things are there. But again, it's a personal choice. I would preferably go for looking at the exiting root. I want to see where the exiting root is. I need to know where the Campbell triangle is. And then let's go in.
Yeah, I think the most important thing is, residents, everybody should start seeing the images properly, seeing where the compression is. So most often in a lytic or in a listhesis, which is more than grade one, usually you will have to do a foraminal decompression. So yeah, most of the times we end up seeing it. So there's no hard and fast rule.
Pankaj sir,
yes please.
Sir, does all low grade degenerative listhesis in your hand needs fusion?
Oh yeah, I think Prabhat, I think this is the same thing which I just bring out in my presentation. I am very comfortable with TLF. I don't leave any patient with PLIF unless there are a lot of issues. You know, I'm running short of time in the OT. The patient has a lot of comorbidities.
No, sir. I mean only you will go for decompression or scar fusion in all the cases of degenerative listhesis.
All degenerative listhesis, spondylolisthesis, there is no role of just instrumentation, because your instrumentation is going to hold till there is fusion. So fusion must for spondylolisthesis in case you are doing instrumentation. There is no role of
No, sir. If there is static listhesis, there is no instability on the flexion extension fins. So in all the cases of grade 1 or grade 2 listhesis, you will go for a fusion or you will opt for only decompression and fixation.
I'm telling you, Prabhat, I'm very comfortable with my screws and fusion. I know the literature might say that in a static listhesis, degen listhesis, maybe you don't have to do it, but I'll be much more comfortable with my screws and my graft in place.
Sir, with your permission, can I add something, sir?
Yes, sir. Please.
Yes. I think the jury is still out on this topic. I think in 2007, there are two meta-analyses which were published and they had contradictory claims. One said the outcomes were similar, and I think the European Spine Journal, they said that the results were superior with fusion. And I think recently there was another publication from Dr. Arvind Kulkarni in clinical spine surgery. So he has tried to give in a scoring system, I think where the maximum score is around 11. And if you score more than 5.5, he has recommended that preferably you should fuse. So his basic criteria were like radiological, clinical and technical. So I still feel, I mean, there is no clear-cut guideline in a low-grade spondylolisthesis that whether it is mandatory to fuse or not. But I found that article by Dr. Arvind Kulkarni very clinically relevant for me with regard to decision-making.
Yeah, I think that's true. See, like if you have a listhesis which is fused, you have to see the natural history. See, the body is trying to make bone and fuse. So in the process of making bone, there will be stenosis. So you need to see how the foraminal stenosis is. So if you have to take out most of the facet to actually do a good decompression, then you are introducing iatrogenic instability. So there you need to fuse. So if you feel that there is absolutely no foraminal compression, you just have to go in and do a decompression there for your traversing nerve root without destabilizing your facets. That's the concept. So if you do not destabilize while going in for decompression in a stable listhesis, you can do a decompression. If you feel that for a good decompression, I have to cut the parse, I have to cut more of facet, keep your screws in place even in then. So you may have to instrument at that time when you are actually destabilizing, doing a decompression.
Open, sir?
Yeah.
Sir, give us some tips and tricks to prevent adjacent segment disease, surgical precautions, yeah. What to take.
So the first thing is preoperatively assess how the patient is. Like, obese patient, a smoker, a patient with flexion extension where there is, some sort of instability you can see. So all these patients, either you have to prophylactically stabilize above or you have to counsel them. Intraoperatively, only thing you can do is, the above facet, you completely do not touch it at all. So you go from the sulcus between the superior articular facet and the transverse process to insert your screws. That's the best chance you can give. The other issue is if you are doing a multi-level, as I told you, if the above segment is very rigid. Say we do a posterolateral fusion, we have observed that the chances of the adjacent segment comes down. Another thing is like, even if we are stopping at L2 or L1, we now start giving a bit of kyphosis to the above segment. We give all the lordosis at L4, L5 in a multi-level segment. So we start the kyphosis slightly earlier so that the dorsolumbar junctional area is very notorious if you completely give lordosis till L2, L1 and just fuse it from L2 to S1 without giving a bit of kyphosis above L1, L2 adjacent segment, we have observed is quite high.
Sir, is there any difference in ischemic and degenerative spondylolisthesis?
Yeah, ischemic is more unstable, and you will have a lot of foraminal stenosis. As Gurdeep was telling, in all this ischemic one, you will have to probably decompress the foramen bilaterally. You cannot just go ahead and do unilaterally. We have observed in my own hands doing unilaterally if the patient has come back with the opposite symptoms. So routinely, we do not do unilateral decompressions in these cases. See your images correctly, what decompression is required.
In which type you prefer miss or open surgery, either ischemic or degenerative, or it is surgeon choice?
Yeah, I would openly admit I am not very good at miss, because in my hands, what I have observed is doing an open one gives me that confidence that I have decompressed all the roots. I am not so good at probably decompressing everything minimally invasively. It takes more time for me. And I have observed that I struggle with that. So I have given up all miss techniques. I do all open. So the patients are quite happy with that. I don't see any excessive blood loss or excessive operative time with our technique, what we are using. So we are happy with it, no problem.
In your view, any difference between ischemic and degenerative for the transient syndrome, as Prabhat asking question, is there any difference of transient syndrome in ischemic or degenerative spondy?
I don't think you can generalize like that. In ischemic, you will have more adjacent, or in degenerative, you will have more adjacent. I think it is patient based. You start seeing how the instability symptoms are progressing for the patient, and carefully observe the adjacent segment. How is the facet? As in the first talk, they were telling if the facet is sagittal, you see how it is. Talk to the patient. If you clearly feel that adjacent segment problem is serious, and that go ahead and fuse that segment also. There you can do a posterolateral fusion only just by putting screws there. So these are the things you need to consider. I don't think you can generalize like for an ischemic there will be more adjacent segment problems.
So do you use some intra connecting road intra road connecting
the transverse connectors, you mean?
Yeah, you use for the long segment.
Use it, absolutely no. So even for scoliosis, we haven't been using transverse connectors much. It's your personal choice as such. If you feel like you need to use a transverse connector, you can use. Clinically, it has been shown that it doesn't make much difference. Yes, biomechanically, studies have shown that it increases the stiffness of the construct. Then again, you need to think about if the construct stiffness has increased, will you increase the adjacent segment? So it's a give and take. You need to see what you want. So if you want more stability, more rigid fixation, maybe yes, you can use it. It's your personal choice.
Sometimes it may complicate the neurology, maybe.
No, I don't think so. That's not an issue at all. It's your personal choice.
Thank you,
sir. How far you expose, sir, the paraspinal muscles?
So usually it depends on the patient. So in a degenerative spine, if retracting laterally is difficult, I don't hesitate going laterally at all, because for me, getting my screws in at a good angle and getting the exposure for good foraminal decompression is important. So it depends on case to case. Many a times you see young patients, you don't need to expose laterally to the facet at all. The muscles will be supple enough to allow you for angulation also. So for say L4, L5 fusion, if you cannot expose laterally to angulate the screw at L4 properly, then you will be violating the L3, L4 facet. So that is more problematic than exposing laterally for me. So I don't hesitate to expose laterally when required.
I think I too go very lateral, especially once you go down, it becomes very difficult for you to angle it very medially unless you have seen the TP. Yeah. And many a times, I don't know if Dr. Pendra would agree, we tend to go Wiltsey kind of approach for L5-L1 because you need to have the right trajectory. That's the most important thing. Once a screw comes out, then it's a bit compromised situation.
Absolutely.
So I think all those things are very theoretical, I would say.
Yeah.
Have your landmarks very clear in front of you.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Sir, one question. Say, patient is having BMT minus 4, say minus 4 osteoporotic patient, and she is having the degenerative listasis at L5, S1. So, would you go for iliac fixation in that case? S2LR or? Iliac or S2LR fixation?
Yeah, it depends on what the patient has. Again, if she requires only a single level fusion and you are worried about the screw fixation, you can use a cement. You can use a cement augmented screw. That should not be an issue.
Sir, one query from me. Sir, you mentioned about that for quite some time you have not been using cage for your tea leaves. What's your experience with regard to the back pain in the immediate post-operative? Do you experience any difference with when you would have using cages previously?
No, if I would have seen any difference, I would have gone back to the cages. Absolutely no. Okay.
And do you use morselized bone graft or you use the tricortical bone graft for the cage-based fusion?
So it is the bone graft we get from the facets and the lamina. We make it into pieces. And as Bhavuk showed, we use a punch to push it in. So we pack it in quite tightly. You can see it completely, almost like good bone there in the interbody region post-operatively in X-ray. So we make sure that we punch it quite hard.
In situ fixation is not required in low grade.
Filled by this method in a low grade spondee.
I didn't get you.
I think the purpose of decompression and fusion both are fulfilled by this method in a low grade spondee.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So the goal of surgery is decompression and fusion. So yeah, that's fine. Absolutely fine.
So any questions or should we wind up?
Yeah, I think it's time. Yeah.
So thank you to Sundar sir and sir and other panelists, all my colleagues and seniors in other AIIMS. Hope we'll come soon with a high grade spondee and spondyl dysplasiasis. Might be in 2 or 3 weeks. I'll plan and inform you all.
I request Madhusudan sir to say something.
Actually, Madhusudan sir has gone for some work.
Okay, somebody sir. From your side, maybe so on behalf of BOA, you say something, sir.
Thank you, everybody. Thanks, the team of AIIMS, for a very wonderful, very informative webinar, sir. I really give a word of thanks on behalf of my president and secretary, sir. And we really wish that we continue more webinars, more learning. Thank you. Thanks a lot from BOA, Ortho TV and IOTV. Thanks a lot, sir.
So, thank you, sir.
With this, I'm ending the live stream.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you, sir. Bye-bye. Take
thank
care.
You, sir. Okay, sir. Bye, sir.
Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.
Bye, sir.